crashing. Okay, well, I will mute everybody now.
Oh, look.
Unfortunately, you won't be able to unmute yourself to the end, but
yeah, very attractive.
Okay.
Normally, he shuts them out when.
There we go. So you're all muted. Your videos are still on, though. You have control over that. Excellent. Right, I will get started.
Have fun with it and see you soon. Bye.
Bravo signor padrone, ora incomincio a capire il mistero. E veder schietto tutto il vostro progetto. A Londra è vero, voi ministro, io corrierò. E la Susanna, segreta ambasciatrice, non sarà, non sarà, Figaro il dice. Se vuol parlare, signor Contino, se vuol ballare, signor Contino, il chitarrino le suonerò. Il chitarrino le suonerò, sì, le suonerò, sì, le suonerò. Se vuol venire nella mia scuola, la capriola le insegnerò. Se vuol venire nella mia scuola, la capriola le insegnerò, sì, le insegnerò, sì, le insegnerò. Saprò, 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 ma piano, 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 piano. Meglio ogni arcano dissimulando scoprir potrà. L'arte scrivendo, le arti prendo, dico facendo, di la scherzando, tutte le macchine rovescerò, rovescerò. L'arte scrivendo, le arti prendo, dico facendo, di la scherzando, tutte le macchine rovescerò, tutte le macchine rovescerò, tutte le macchine rovescerò, rovescerò, rovescerò. Se vuol ballare, signor Contino, se vuol ballare, signor Contino, il chitarrino le suonerò. Il chitarrino le suonerò, sì, le suonerò, sì, le suonerò.
It's an F.
Thank you very much indeed. One thing you, it's all very weird actually, because you see everybody clapping like this, but you can't hear anybody. That's one thing that you don't have to do in live performance, which is stop the backing track before the advert starts. But you know, we'll get back to it soon. Good evening everybody, and thank you all very much indeed for coming today. This is a talk about my life as a young opera singer and how the coronavirus pandemic has affected my career. Don't worry, it's not all doom and gloom, and I'm excited to share with you some of my stories and anecdotes of what I've been up to in the past year. I started with a short aria from Mozart's La Notte di Figaro, as in March 2020, I was performing The Marriage of Figaro with Opera North's Whistle Stop Opera, and I was playing the title role. It was the last professional engagement that I had before the coronavirus pandemic truly began. I'm going to just share my screen so you can see my slides. I finished my master's degree at the Royal College of Music in London back in 2019, and I was enjoying relatively good success following graduation. The Royal College of Music was fantastic and provided me with an education and experiences that were invaluable for preparing me for life as a professional opera singer. A typical week was busy with 3 hours of Italian, 1.5 hours of English, 3 hours of German, 3 hours of French, 1 hour of Spanish, Russian and Czech, which were rotated weekly, 2 hours of stagecraft, 3 hours of individual coaching and teaching, and because I was reading the more academic Master of Music degree, 3 hours of seminars with our personal coach. Every Wednesday afternoon, the RCM also hosted masterclasses with world-renowned artists. Each of the master's students would take their turn performing in these masterclasses, and I was lucky enough to perform for Sir Thomas Allen and Anne Murray. During the opera season, we would also have a full-time opera schedule to fit in amongst our classes. I concluded my studies at the Royal College of Music with a number of exams, mainly 2 song recitals with music in 5 different languages, including a composer with one of the best names that I think I've ever heard, which was Clemens Erwin Heinrich Karl Bonaventura Freiherr von und zu Frankenstein. I also had to sing 2 opera scenes. Mine were Eugene Onegin by Tchaikovsky and Mozart's Così fan tutte. I also had a 45-minute recital with my selected programme consisting of Grieg's Sexlieder, Martin Bussy's 4 garden songs, and Poulenc's incredibly rude song cycle called Chanson Gaillarde. I will just play you a short segment of the Poulenc. As I chose to read the more academical master's degree at the RCM, I also had to present a lecture recital, which I chose to do on the lost music by composers in concentration camps, mainly focusing on Lieder by Viktor Ullmann. During my final year of my master's degree, I ventured out to Poland and Germany for my research, and I even participated in a recital series at the Akademie der Künste, which was in Berlin. After graduating, I went straight into a busy performance schedule. Summer 2019, I joined Longborough Festival Opera for the chorus of Donizetti's Anna Bolena. I created the role of Chle in Elphin Jones's opera Her Face Was of Flowers at the Tête-à-Tête Opera Festival. Now, playing this role really presented challenges as I'd never played a brute before. And then in contrast, I performed as Aeneas in Dido and Aeneas at the Rideau Festival with Echo Choir and musical director Eamon Dugan from the 16. I also reprised the role of Don Alfonso in Mozart's Così fan tutte with Devon Opera, which became my first full role that I have performed in Italian. This modern production features disguises of Ferrando and Guglielmo in stereotypical 70s attire, as you can see on these 2 slides here. There's Ferrando in the center, and that's Guglielmo there. That's me as Don Alfonso. And this is the whole cast. We have Ferrando, we have Fiordiligi, Don Alfonso, our musical director, and this is Despina, Dorabella, and Guglielmo. And we have Despina as a bit of a guru, sort of like medic. That's one of the fun aspects of the opera world. You get to have a different office every single day, and you get to play different characters every day. For instance, on a typical week around Easter, I could be expecting to play Jesus in Bach's St. John Passion one day, The next day I could be condemning him to death by being Pilate, and then the day after, as a complete contrast, I could be dressed up as a lion performing as Snug in Britain's A Midsummer Night's Dream. It's one of the beauties of being a performer. You think I'm joking, but take a look at some of the ridiculous costumes that I have worn in actual shows. So this is me in Lennox Barclay's A Dinner Engagement as Lord Dumno. And with my wife here, we are serenading a tomato whilst I am wearing lipstick and a sweatband. This is me as said lion in A Midsummer Night's Dream. And this was me as Dulcamara in Donizetti's Elixir of Love, because the director thought it would be funny to put us on a segue, which almost resulted in a very funny, well, probably not funny, but accident when the orchestra pit was quite unexpectedly big. From taking selfies on stage to riding a segue and being dressed as an ant like this, and then exactly 42 seconds later, during the same performance, I had to go from this costume to this costume here as a priest. Our best time, as I said, was 42 seconds getting from out of this costume, makeup off, into this costume. I've had my fair share of costume changes. As you can see on this last picture, as well as costume, there is also a lot of makeup. The RCM were great, as we were even taught how to apply base and aging makeup. Applying the makeup takes long, if not longer, than putting on the costume. This picture here shows me as Antonio in Mozart's The Marriage of Figaro, which I did at the Royal College of Music. And I'm going to show you a time-lapse video, which has been reduced from 40 minutes to 40 seconds, to show how my makeup was applied for my role as Antonio. I am aware that there is a bit of a lag with the video, but you will get the idea anyway. The highlight of my summer had to be joining Harry Christopher's 16 for the world premiere and CD recording of James Macmillan's Le Grand Inconnu, which achieved the review 5 stars for a piece I would like to hear again and again. The choral sound blazed at the climaxes. The orchestral colours were from a vivid paint box, which was described in the Times newspaper. I'm just going to play you a quick clip now of that piece. Here we go. Success continued into the autumn, where I went abroad. Starting in the Isle of Man, I performed the role of Schaunard in Puccini's La Bohème with Erin Art Centre. Now this is what you call one of the dream of contracts, as the cast was so friendly and our free time was often spent in the many bars of Port Erin playing cards, or even in September swimming in the bitterly cold ocean. The man who was playing the role of Benoit was a local farmer. So on our rest days, he invited us down to his house to try out driving his tractor and his quad bike. I may have got a bit carried away, and even Shanar had a turn in full costume. The contract also marked my bugle playing in an opera debut. And as my first bohème, I grew to love the opera more and more than I already did. I found the roles of the four males to be extremely fun, and Neil and I, pictured here, had an onstage challenge to see who could eat the most wine, or Ribena, and eat the most snacks whilst on stage. During our run, I think it may have been a tie. That's the issue with life as an opera singer. Whilst on a contract, you become very connected and attached to your opera family. You're living, you're eating, and you're relaxing with your friends and colleagues. However, once it's over, it can feel very empty indeed. Now, from one bohème came another, where in winter 2019, I performed the role of Marcello in La Bohème with Hampstead Garden Opera back in London. The one thing that I learnt in La Bohème is that the characters, well, they never stop eating. And although this time, the food was improvised and imaginary. With only 6 weeks between my first bohème as Shanar, which was in English, and my second bohème as Marcello, which was in Italian, this was quite the turnaround. Marcello was the biggest role I'd ever done, and with the added pressure of attendance of English touring opera, The Guardian, Opera Magazine, and Opera North, I found that I really needed to pull out all the stops. I've always found learning music a challenge. I find I have to be in the right mindset to learn it, and I often find that I learn music well under pressure. Here is a sample of my digital score of La Bohème, which I thought that you might find interesting. Firstly, when learning a piece of music, I'd start by listening to a recording, or if it's a piece of contemporary music, I would sit down and play the vocal and accompanying parts on the piano. This is mainly to find the harmonic and melodic structure of the music so that I know exactly where the melody leads. Then I sing the vocal line to vowel sounds, and before singing the text, I translate it word for word. You may notice on the score that I highlight different areas of the music. I'd always highlight my line in one colour, highlight the expression markings in another colour, and write my stage directions in a different colour. It just makes it a lot easier to visualise, especially when I'm committing a 3-hour opera to memory. And although the learning process may seem slow, it means I actually memorise it a lot quicker. After I've ditched the score, I write out the whole role word for word in a notepad with translations underneath so that it's easier to transport or use in a rehearsal room. Learning music is then repetition. However, I try and find different scenarios and locations to practice. The benefit of being a singer is that you can take your music with you virtually anywhere. Yes, I'll work on the technical and language details at home or in vocal lessons or coaching, but I learned the majority of La Bohème whilst riding my bike through the dusk of central London. This means that I associate certain landscapes to the imagery of the music. On one of my rides, I even came across this cafe called Café Bohème on Old Compton Street. Now, if that doesn't scream La Quartier Latin, then I don't know what does. In December 2019, I made my solo debut at the Royal Albert Hall, singing to a crowd of 4,000 people. I performed at the grand final of the ATP Champions Tennis Tour. Now, as career highlights go, this was a big one. Firstly, my dressing room came fully equipped with a living room, dining room, and a washroom with unlimited food and drink. Here's a clip of me singing Bizet's Toreador from Carmen to the crowd who even joined in. And feel free to join in as well if you want to. Yes, we are, and 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 Many other engagements happened in late 2019, including the Baroque Messiah I hosted with a familiar face conducting. I also had whistle stop trips to Paris and Vienna for auditions and concerts, singing at my first four German carol service at St. Bartholomew the Great, and singing my first full length recital to a packed St. Martin in the Fields. 2019 had certainly been an incredible year, and I was so excited about 2020. After watching me in Hampstead Garden Opera's production of La Boheme, I was successful in auditioning for a role with Opera North. This started with a touring contract, and I was performing the role of Figaro in Opera North's Whistle Stop Opera's production of Figaro. I spent January to March 2020 in the north of England and performed the show a total of 32 times. Firstly, the cast were idols to me. Both Temba and Alison have performed roles at English National Opera, and Lizzie have performed roles at the Royal Opera House. Although I was a few years younger than the other cast members, I very much felt like the underdog. We were given 1 week to learn the opera, which had been cut into a show of less than 60 minutes. It was more of a show to introduce and encourage people to opera rather than the full-length complicated show. But during the intense rehearsal schedule, we had to adapt to different locations, especially considering we'd been performing this show in bars, restaurants, theatres, school halls. It really proved my previous statement of every day we have a different office. The show was a tremendous success, receiving excellent reviews from both critics and audiences alike. The tour moved to London, and we were about to sign a contract for a tour extension when disaster struck. In mid-March, or about a week ago this time last year, the emails started pouring in thick and fast, with cancellations going right into 2021. It was a week I'll never forget, and at this time we had no idea to what extent the pandemic would affect our lives. It was extremely difficult for me. My 2020 calendar was wiped overnight. Over 100 engagements cancelled in the space of 1 week. I signed off my emails and closed down my social media for a period of time, and I tried to come to terms with what exactly was happening. As a freelancer in the gig economy, I rely mainly on self-employed income to survive, but also because performing is my passion, I was coming to terms with the fact that I most certainly wouldn't be performing to a live audience for a significant amount of time. I had a long phone call with my parents, and on March 23rd, 5 minutes after Boris's announcement, they were in the car, on the way to London to pick me up. I packed up all my things and tried to plan what I would need for the original 12-week lockdown. It was certainly a situation that I and many others never had been in before. We arrived back in Whitchurch, Shropshire, in the early hours of the morning, and the morning after, I pondered over my now empty diary. This thought really hit home this week, especially on the anniversary of the first lockdown just a couple of days ago. The one saving grace that I had was that I'd been part of an online music school called Your Space Music Lessons since 2017. The ironic thing is, back in January, I'd called my agents to request a decline in the amount of students I took on. How the tables turned on March 24th when I called them back asking if I could now retract that statement. Now, all of us here have had Zoom rehearsals, some of us have had Zoom lessons. And my Zoom setup started modestly with just a laptop and a piano, as seen here, but then expanded to my current setup, which now has lights, dual screens, enhanced microphones, and upgrades on speakers. Little and often was my motto. For instance, if it's not broken, don't fix it. But also to make a comfortable dwelling to meet the demand of not the expected demand. Back in March 2020, I had a total of 6 students, whereas this week I'm teaching a total of 34. What was amazing was the fact that our music school reached out all over the world, and I now teach students in Belgium, France, Guatemala, Iceland, Italy, India, Jamaica, Qatar, New Zealand, Spain, Switzerland, the Netherlands, Norway, UK, and the USA. I've taught every, apart from tomorrow, I've taught every people in those countries this week. Talk about adjusting to different time zones, including tomorrow, where the hour goes forward as well. And some days I'll start at 7:30 a.m., which hits the USA students, and then I'll finish at 10 p.m. with a student in New Zealand. I realised that I really enjoy tutoring, and after what have been a devastating few weeks, I devoted a huge amount of time to redeveloping my teaching practice. My students range from opera and classical and jazz to musical theatre, and over the course of this year especially, I've met all sorts of students. Some want to pass exams, some to prepare for auditions, and some, and I quote, want to go and win the X Factor. I have them all. I'll share a few success stories with you. One of my students, who I'm going to call Zara for the purpose of this anecdote, was told that when she was in school that she couldn't sing. And then 14 years later, at the age of 32, Zara approached me for online singing lessons. It took her 5 months to be able to sing a whole song to me. And after a lot of time, dedication, and many cups of tea, Zara successfully auditioned and obtained a role in her local musical theatre group. It's a goal that she had dreamed about for so many years. And up until the most recent lockdown, Zara also went into a local school every week to play for the children. My students have passed exams. Actually, one of my students passed his grade 8 Trinity from India. He passed his grade 8 Trinity exam with merit, which is pretty good for him. And I've also had to learn a lot of boards as well. There's Trinity, ABRSM for classical singing, there's LCM, ABRSM for musical theatre, then there's also the RSL for rock exams, and there's also boards in Iceland, which I can't say the name of, and there's USA as well for additional song exams. Thankfully, all my students have passed exams, with the majority receiving the mark of distinction. Although I have previous experience with online tuition, I've also had to adapt my teaching style. Mainly this involves many more energetic warm-ups, including one which you can play on Zoom, which is called Catch the Click, which is basically where you have a click and you throw it across the screen, somebody has to catch it, and then you throw it back to somebody else on the screen. And like you were saying in your talk before, you can also do that thing where you pass like an object from one person to another. It's great when it works. I also try yoga poses as well, and in a recent class of mine, we had a very determined dog who wouldn't stop walking all over my student as she lay down to do some deep breathing exercises. Your space music were also very beneficial to not just to the students, but to the teachers as well, and they conducted online performance clubs as well. As we came to terms with the lockdown, I decided that I needed to occupy my time more effectively than watching Netflix or also joining the challenge of making the most banana breads that we could in a week. Like most people, I turned to walking and going outdoors and trying all sorts of gin, for instance. Luckily, Whitchurch is surrounded by vast fields and woodland, so I'm only a stone's throw away from the beautiful scenery. Sometimes, like this video suggests, I would even create woodland swings and obstacles on my walks.
And did those feet in ancient times walk upon England's mountains green? And was the holy Lamb of God on England's pleasant pastures seen? And was the countenance divine shine forth upon oak-clad hills? And was Jerusalem builded here among those Tarsanic hills?
We were very fortunate with the weather during the initial lockdown, and as I have always been a keen cyclist, I decided to take my cycling to the next level. I made it my goal to go and do some exercise for at least an hour a day, whether that be walking outdoors or cycling, and I later averaged 300 kilometers or 188 miles a week on my bike. I recall cycling 50 kilometers one morning and I didn't pass a single car. It's a world away from what we're used to at this current time. I'd regularly cycle up Shrewsbury, Bangor-on-Dee, Nantwich, Renbury. I don't think I ventured to Oswestry. I got pretty close. I think I like bypassed it when near Gabowen. And once the lockdown was lifted slightly, I ventured out to Llangollen and even took a trip up to the Lake District to tackle the infamous Rhinos Pass. With gradients of up to 30% in places, this was one of the most positive outcomes of lockdown. I became so much fitter that when I briefly returned to London over summer, I was almost 2 stone lighter, and I even ticked an item off my bucket list, which was cycling from London to Brighton and back. This 195 kilometer marathon ride took me less than 8 hours, and after starting at 6 a.m, I still managed to make it back to teach an online lesson at 4. Over the whole year, I amassed a total of 5,000 miles of cycling, and this year I'm currently on track to hit 6,000 miles. That's more miles than I travel in my car. Cheer me on this year as I've entered myself into 3 triathlons, the first being now postponed in June. Sort of a bit crazy now, to be honest. This is how I coped with my lockdown blues. I found that social media was and continues to be so toxic, and the news was getting extremely upsetting every single day, and I needed some sort of breakaway. I didn't realise it at the time, but the main reason that my mental health didn't suffer last year was because I was able to distance myself from a lot of negativity. I found my love of exercise, and I now find myself making time every single day to get outdoors, rain or shine. And actually, I did go on a very quick 20-minute bike ride just before this as well, just to get out. Despite enjoying the weather, I was still missing performing terribly. The Concordia Foundation, who I performed with in the past, offered me a grant in exchange for a video to thank our sponsors. It coincided with the clap for our heroes on Thursday evenings. I released the first online video, which I chose to sing Over the Rainbow. From this, I also offered to sing a hymn of the week for my local church, St. Altman's Parish Church. This was great as it kept me motivated to keep singing, and it was lovely to hear how much the congregation appreciated these hymns, especially considering that some were played at funerals because, of course, no choir and a limited number of congregation were allowed to attend. You can also see in that photo the results of the lockdown haircut, which was basically, you know, short back and sides all over. Other events included Zoom concerts, as pictured here. The only difference was when people clapped, like you saw before, you could see that their movement and everyone was muted. It's a very bizarre experience. And that's how it continued for many weeks. The hardest part of lockdown was the fact that I just felt that I didn't have a purpose anymore. I had very little motivation and I wasn't booked for any concerts. And of course, any concerts that were still in the diary were being cancelled later on. So I decided to do something about it. During the summer, the weather was beautiful, and with the generosity of 3 families, I put on 3 outdoor concerts. Naturally, these concerts sold out overnight, partially because we had to adhere to strict social distancing and the maximum audience was so low, but also because people were craving gatherings and live music. As well as performing myself, I also wanted to try and encourage local artists to get involved. We'd all been hit, not just financially, but mentally too. So I was keen to get more people involved. On August the 14th, 2020, I sang at my first public performance since March the 8th. At the concert, I was accompanied by Martin Bussey and Holly Teague, and we presented an outdoor concert of light-hearted opera arias, musical theatre and song, which also included some of Martin's compositions. At concert number two, we headed to Ash, where I was joined by Halle cellist Nicholas Trigstad, jazz pianist David Campbell, and classical pianist Richard James. And at concert number three, Martin and I headed to the Cheshire border, where he even had a friendly page-turner. All concerts went very smoothly, and except the last one, where the rain poured down as soon as I finished my final note, the weather was glorious. I've put on concerts before, however, I was overwhelmed by the positive responses that came after our performances, and I hope that we can replicate some of these concerts this year, and if social distancing is less, we'll be able to have more audience members too. The success of these concerts led to more, and I found myself performing at lots of concerts in Kent and Cornwall. I was particularly amused at one of the concerts in Cornwall, as the weather was absolutely awful. At the concert, I was singing with many of my friends, some of whom had been mid-run on the London West End or on national tours. Firstly, the wind was so shocking that on more than one occasion, a Marilyn Monroe moment almost occurred. Secondly, the wind was so bad that it distorted all our microphones and you couldn't hear us. And thirdly, the wind was so bad that the audience progressively produced layer upon layer upon layer. In the end, some of them were in full dressing gowns and duvets on top of their clothes. Now that's dedication. Throughout September and October 2020, guidelines relaxed even further, and I was allowed to perform indoors for the first time since the spring. The only difference was the strict COVID secure measures had to be implemented, such as keeping a maximum audience side and one-way systems for audiences and performers. We also had to keep all doors open to create ventilation, and all audience members had to wear masks. However, it was a small price to pay for keeping music alive. In this photo, you'll see that I am with a mezzo-soprano, who is Esme, and we are singing Mozart's Il Core di Donno from Così. It caused much hilarity when we had to sanitise the locket on stage and, from a distance, pine for each other's love in this very not-distanced duet. Even COVID couldn't stop the world premiere of Martin Bussey's timeless figure occurring, as we were so determined to keep the music going. Instead of movement and interaction between musicians, we were told to stand on designated spots and not move. The scenery was made up of slides taken by photographer Laurel Turton, and we had to rehearse in isolation, coming together finally at a huge church in Manchester, again to keep distancing. You can watch the full video on my website. However, I am going to give you a clip of the fifth movement here, which hopefully you'll be able to see the slides as well.
When I began, clocks were for wealthy men, precise, mechanical, made by a master craftsman. Wheels and pinions, train bar.
I hope you spotted some of the familiar photography there as well from Chester and Whitchurch Joyce's clocks. One of the groups that I felt that had been overlooked during the pandemic were residents in care homes. So with a close friend, we decided to bring the music to them. To minimise risk, we didn't step foot inside the care home, but instead we stood outside to sing them. The other side of the door, which is not pictured, the care home had decorated with curtains and a show of floral bouquets. These types of concerts continue for some time, and we tried to become more innovative in the ways that we could to bring music to the people. One way to do that was so simple, it was singing on people's doorstep. We partnered with Age UK and visited the most vulnerable people, those who had little interaction with people for most of 2020. Accompanying my Bluetooth speaker, I cycled to residents' houses across central London and sang a small programme of music. As you can see by these two photos, this was far from the concert setting that I was used to. But despite the rain, I kept on going and just got wet. I'm now going to sing part of the programme that I sang there, which is On the Street Where You Live.
Often walked down the street before, but the pavement always stayed beneath my feet before. Now at one time I several stories high, knowing I'm on the street where you lilac trees in the heart of town. Can you hear the lark in any other part of town? Does enchantment sort of every door? No, it's just on the street where you live. And oh, the towering feeling, just to know somehow you are here. The overpowering feeling that any second you may suddenly appear. Stop and stare, they don't bother me, for there's no else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you
The second lockdown hit during winter 2020, where it put a halt to all events for the time being. However, this struck another initiative which I got involved in. Charles Court Opera released their Dial a Song. where people got in touch to nominate someone to receive a song via telephone call. This was me in the photo singing Shine, Jesus Shine for a lady's birthday. She even joined in as well. Other projects that I collaborated in included with the composer Louis Mander. The piece seen here was recorded in isolation with the string player Jonathan recording all four string parts. And I will just show you this now on my iPad. Here we go. In my living room, I hooked up a microphone to my phone and recorded my part. Take a listen to the finished result. As well as this, Martin and I also collaborated again. This time I recorded some of Martin's pieces, which were for Composer's Edition. Recorded at social distance, Martin and I rehearsed earlier this year, and I'm glad to see that the pieces are now online on YouTube. And I'm going to play you one of the YouTube links of As Adam from Children of Adam. I do have to extend my thanks to Martin, and I know that a lot of you have only met him very briefly in person. But Martin actually was a bit of a lifeline during the coronavirus pandemic, because there was a bit of time where I was going up and down, positive and negatives. And Martin always kept me on the straight and narrow, checking in, making sure I was okay. But also he was giving me stuff to do, like Timeless Figure, which is now available in all shops, by the way, in case you're wanting to buy them. Just the score here. But also he just was able to really encourage me to keep on singing. So I'm very grateful. And you've got an amazing conductor as well. The one thing that coronavirus did do is it made me more of a determined person. And now more than ever, I am ensuring that I keep the music going. To those who follow me or Martin on Facebook will notice that this year that I've been recording informally a folk song each week. So this started off back in December, where I sang Peter Cornelius is Three Kings. And as time goes on, I've been able to use live pianists to further encourage music making. And I will continue to do this for as long as I am able. Earlier this month as well, I also met with Olivia Hunt and John Hosking, and we recorded an online recital to help fund their next CD. In the meantime, I expect performances to be substantially effective for the remainder of the year, hopefully opening up in the autumn. And currently I'm taking on a new venture and have taken on a part-time position as a music teacher in a primary school. It's probably why I look so tired on this Zoom call. Alongside my online tuition, which I will continue for a while, with the bonus being that is portable. But I'm confident about the future and I'm looking forward to some exciting contracts which may be around the corner. And as well as this, I'm also delighted that I'm involved in a brand new company called Street Theatre. Similar to last year, we're performing on people's doorsteps, and this is currently just in London, but will be available to many people hopefully very soon. My next concert's in Fulham on Sunday, where I am singing The Way You Look Tonight for a couple's missed anniversary, which was their wedding song. I've tried to be really innovative and creative in ways that I make music during the pandemic. It has been an unprecedented situation. However, I'm proud and very thankful to many people that I've been able to keep music alive during the last year. I'm going to end with two songs. The first one is Loch Lomond, which is a folk song, which will be one of my folk songs that I'm going to record next. So I really hope that you enjoy this one.
By yon bonny banks and by yon bonny braes, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond, where me and my true love ever won to keep, on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. Ye'll tak the high road, and I'll tak the low road, and I'll be in Scotland ever ye. For me and my true love will never meet again on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. 'Twas there that we parted in yon shady glen, on the steep, steep sides of Enlomond, where deep in purple hue the highland hills we view, and the moon coming out in the gloaming. Oh, ye'll tak the high road, and I'll tak the low road, and I'll be in Scotland afore ye. Me and my true love will never meet again on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. Mm-hmm. birdies sing, and the wild flowers spring, and in sunshine the waters are sleeping. But the broken-hearted kens nay second spring again. Though the wayfall may cease, pray the greeting. O ye'll tak the high road, and I'll tak the low road, and I'll be in Scotland afore ye. For me and my true love will never meet again on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. We'll never meet again on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond.
Thank you. And to end today, I am going to sing one of my favourite musical pieces from South Pacific. This is Some Enchanted Evening.
Enchanted evening, you may see a stranger, you may see a stranger across a crowded room, and somehow you know even then, that somewhere you'll see again and again. Some enchanted evening, someone may be laughing, you may hear her laughing across a crowded room, and night after night, as strange as it seems, the sound of a laughter will sing in your dreams. Who can explain it? Who can tell you why? Fools give you reasons, wise men never try. Some enchanted evening, when you find your true love, when you feel her call you across a crowded room, then fly to her side and make her your own. All through your life you may dream all alone. Once you have found her, never let her go. Once you have found her, never let her go.
Thank you very much indeed. Oops. There we go, you can all unmute yourself now.
Wow. Wow. That specific, one of the first films I went to see in the Empire Cinema in Shrewsbury when I was a kid.
Was it indeed? Oh my goodness.
Peter, thank you. What an amazing story. So varied, so interesting. And you know, it's absolutely fantastic how you brought music to so many people at the start of your career, performing in the Albert Hall, the O2 Arena, St Martin's the Field, but also singing upside down in the woods. in Whitchurch and at anybody's doorstep and private gardens. I mean, it really is a most fantastic story. I'm aging 40 years in 40 seconds is quite memorable, I have to say. A little disconcerting. I have to say I'm quite glad I've done it over 40 years. But and also the only other little thing was I was interested to hear you talk about the Erin Arts Festival, because downstairs I've got a grand piano that I inherited from my aunt.
Wow.
Used by people going to the Erin Arts Festival to rehearse. Performance of the piano was used. So, wonderful story, and thank you for sharing. Ups and downs and how you've dealt with adversity over the last few months is truly impressive and awe-inspiring. So, all credit to you, thank you so much. So, can I just start off just a few questions and ask you, where is the place you'd most like to perform and why, once you've got the world oyster again?
You know what? I think I'd actually like to travel out of Britain for a bit. I'd like to go and tackle go into the Berlin Staatsoper. That would be my absolute dream to perform there. So I'd like to perform there, and I'd also like to do obviously the English National Opera or Royal Opera House as well. But I think going to Germany at the moment, I've got my GCSE German books back there, which I'm redoing again, just so I can learn German again. But it's going a bit slow at the moment. But yeah, I think that would be my next. That's what I'll do in a couple of years when my voice has matured a bit more.
Fabulous. So guys, open to you. Barbara.
I just loved it that you have such an eclectic taste in music, because when I studied music as a young woman, I used to love musical theatre, but because I was being classically trained, it was frowned upon, you know, that you should mix the two. And I love it now that I think young singers coming through and young musicians are more prepared to, you know, take up either, well, move from one field to another. And it's just lovely, because I love classical music as well and modern classical. I did a lot of Benjamin Britten and then I did a lot of Lieder, actually, again, all when I was much younger, not now. It was a very narrow world. You know, you had to stick to one discipline and not vary. So it's lovely that you can do them all. Great. Really enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm. To hear that. Thank you for your
well said.
Yeah. There's a lot of I teach in a very classical way, but the majority of my students are not classical. And I'm not gonna force classical music on them, because it's not for everybody. You know, opera is not for everybody either. And I wouldn't say that I enjoy every opera that I sing or every opera that I watch. But it's just one thing that I can do with voices is I know how to look after a voice, because I've studied it in depth for six years. So I know that the classical style works. And actually a few of my students have gone on to quite a big things, actually, which is really good. But they've all been taught in this classical way, which shows how to produce your voice naturally rather than squeezing the larynx and getting this really forced sound, which is why a lot of pop singers nowadays have very prosperous careers, but very short careers.
Yeah.
Fortunately.
Fiona.
Peter, that was wonderful. I love Benjamin Britten operas.
How do you feel about it? Are there any that you'd like to sing in?
I do. I love Benjamin Britten. I've actually got the I know Billy Budd. One of my audition arias is "Look Through the Port" from Billy Budd. But I've done, as I mentioned actually before, the Midsummer Night's Dream. So they come, they're very big operas. I'll go and quickly grab the score. The opera and scores are huge.
Silver Line.
Yeah, so like the Midsummer Night's Dream. So like an average score would be around, well, like Martin's size, like that's a normal size score. And this is like tremendously huge in this size as well. They might to make themselves that they can't fit on a bookshelf, which is a bit annoying. And they're also really expensive. This book was £120 for this one score because the Britten Foundation. I love Midsummer Night's Dream. That's one of my favourite operas. I like Paul Bunyan as well, but Billy Budd as well. I'd really like to go Billy Budd eventually when I'm, as my teacher said, when I look as though I could hit a man. So maybe I need to just bulk up a bit. But I do. I love Britten's Midsummer Night's Dream. I've done Duke Theseus, I've done Snug. I've done quite a bit of Demetrius in scenes as well. And I love his folk song arrangements as well, which...
Oh, yes.
I'm trying to get through quite a few of those at the moment because they've got the normal tunes, but the... luckily, I'm not playing them, but the accompaniment underneath is very intricate. I very much enjoy Britten. Yeah, he only lived down the road from me, actually. I'm currently in Chiswick, and he was down in Barnes, I think. Quite a lot of the composers were down there.
Mm-hmm. Can I just butt in again, only talking about Britten, because you're bringing all these memories back. When I was at a music school in Liverpool, the first solo, we used to always do our concerts at St. George's Hall in Liverpool. Mm. And for some reason, my teacher chose me singing the flower song from The Rape of Lucretia. I was 17 and absolutely terrified. And the best crit I got in the local paper was that I sort of brought out the feeling of the song, you know, and, you know, I looked like I just had the misfortune, you know, because I was shaking like a leaf, you know, so it's always stuck in my mind, that one. Sorry, I'm carried away by your performance.
You do have to count with Britten. I shouldn't say that as a singer, but giving us a bad reputation here. But yeah, the score was marked up. As with a lot of contemporary music, actually, I wouldn't call Britten contemporary though. Actually, but all the beats are marked out. Like, I don't know if you can actually see that very well. But it's all marked out with the pencil box, making sure.
Oh, Joe has gone fishing in 7.
If people do have questions, it's sometimes easier to write them in the chat as well, so we're not all jumping over each other if people do, or I think sourcing people anyway.
Morva.
Yeah, if you haven't already, what would be the one role you'd aspire to perform?
Do you know what? I love, I'd really like to do the role that I've already done, Marcello. I fell in love with that role and I'd love to do that again. I cannot wait actually to do that again. I'm trying to audition whenever I can. But also I haven't yet, I've done Figaro, but I'd like to do the Count in Figaro. I'm currently learning that because my voice since singing Figaro has gone a lot higher. But the Count is, he's a great guy. Yeah, he's good. I got quite a lot of coaching on the Count's aria during my time at Opera North, because actually they were doing, that's why we did the Figaro, they were doing it on the stage at the Grand Theatre as well. So I got some great coaching on the actual role. So yeah, hopefully in the near future, we'll see. But because I know Figaro, they tend to put me in that role at the moment. So I just need to keep drinking beer and whiskey to keep my voice low. And all but don't tell your conductor that.
What happened to all the altos?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it's empty.
Is the beer and whiskey professional advice?
He's the beer and whiskey professional advisor. I do have an extensive collection of whiskey, so. But I don't have any beer in, actually. I've got wine in it.
Come on, tell him. You need to be careful or you'll be Falstaff next.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I shouldn't
say. Were you a chorister when you were a boy?
No, I wasn't, actually. I went to quite a musical school. I went to Abbeygate College in Chester. But I couldn't ever get to, I was invited to go to Chester Cathedral, but I lived in Whitchurch and my parents both worked full time. So it was just a bit of a commitment for them to, I made the decision actually because it was just a bit too far. But do you know what? It's something I do not regret because I think I would have come out a better sight reader. But, and this, I mean, it's controversial, but I think some choral singers are quite set in their ways. You sit very much, again, this is just my own opinion, so, but they very much stand like they're there with the book, and sometimes find it difficult to move with the freedom. So actually I don't regret not being a choral singer. I love singing in choirs, but I'm glad that I wasn't a chorister when I was younger.
When you have a chorister, though, you have to have the book because you've only seen the music on the Friday.
Yeah, I know that. They get stuck in.
Possibly the one before.
Yeah.
There are six of us in Cantiones who can't wait to get back.
I bet, yeah. When's your first fingers crossed, rehearsal?
No, well, we can't go back singing in church. Or maybe in about a month.
Do you know, there's been, I think actually, I saw from my choir in, I sing at a church just up the road in Marble Arch,
The guidance has changed, actually.
They've changed the guidance so that five people can sing from, I think it's like the 28th or 29th of March. Yeah.
Next week.
I saw that.
Yeah. If singing and chanting is essential to an act of worship, you're allowed to small groups of singers will be allowed to perform or rehearse for performance only where essential to perform an act of communal worship. So that
I think we're essential.
We can be creative in our interpretation.
That's what it says anyway. So I know we're going back from Easter Day. I think we're going back. There's only five of us in the choir, but
how many?
Only five of us in the choir. Oh. So we do. We turn up at 9 o'clock, 9:15 on Sunday mornings, and the service is at 10. And we do the mass setting, and usually it's a whole mass, an anthem, and a few hymns. But at the moment, it's a condensed mass. And a couple of anthems, which is really nice. Yeah, it's very nice. Keeps the sight reading.
The regulations now.
Yeah.
Peter, we've heard a lot about the difficulties from not being a member of the EU anymore, and that you then have to get visa sorted out and all that sort of thing. Is this causing you a problem for your likely future, do you think? Or is it going to be sorted out?
In the short term, yes, it will. I'm taking a bit of a break from opera choruses and young artist programs at the moment just because of my teaching job, just so I want to get a bit of financial security. But yes, you have to have a tier, I can't remember what it is now, but there's a tier visa, which is about £400. And also the thing that I have noticed, however, is when I was applying in January before I started my teaching job, companies in so like the Bastille in France, the Vienna Staatsoper, the Frankfurt Opera, they were all favouring singers from the EU because it's too expensive to keep British singers But yeah, it's something I haven't done a huge amount of research into it at the moment, but it does, I think it will level out, and I think the government needs to do something with, they rejected, didn't they, the free EU visa for musicians, travelling musicians. So I hope that they backtrack on that, but we'll see. I think it will come more apparent in a year's time.
Yeah.
But I do think at the moment performances are still, especially like France has gone back into a lockdown. So I'll see in a year's time when I'm reapplying for stuff.
They've made a lot of threats that they won't be able to afford to go.
Well, good luck with it. Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent, I suppose COVID having put a block on everything, perhaps, who knows, has it allowed somebody to be working it out. But it seemed to me that it was lining up to be an enormous drag on British artists working on the continent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It definitely is, and it's not great for us. I mean, I'm meant to be going out in August. I've got a contract in France to do Carmen. I'm Escamillo in Carmen. So that's for 3 weeks in August. So I'll see then as well, because I've decided to drive there as well rather than take the plane, because there's also because of COVID as well. I don't know if I'll have the vaccine by then either. We'll see. And then we'll be able to get one of those vaccine passports, in which case. So, but I don't know, Brexit's very much up in the air at this moment in time, but it's not as freeing as it was. And it does make everything a lot more expensive, just because you had to have a visa per place that you go to rather than an international. Mm-hmm. It does cost quite a bit. But yeah, as I said, we'll see. And that's why I'm saving up at the moment as well. So we'll see with this year, taking this stable income of the teaching for a year and then come back out, so I don't have to then worry about the finances.
Yeah.
And concentrate on the art, which is, you've got to do.
So Peter, a huge thank you for speaking and seeing this with this evening. It's been a fantastic experience, and I'm sure a lot of us feel really inspired by what you do, and we'll try to live up to you once we start singing again, obviously, because we're going to get nowhere near your level. But perhaps you could put in a word for us with a certain Martin Bussey as to whether he'll let us loose on his music. We won't do it the justice that you have, but I'd quite like to have a shot at it.
Martin's music is very good, and I'm contractually obliged to sit, no jokes, but you should, it's good. it's really good. I very much I do enjoy singing Martin's music, and actually what's great about Martin, though, I know he's on this call, is that he really helps, though. He's like, he knows, obviously he's written it, but he just like, he knows how to get the best out of a singer. So actually if you listen to Timeless Figure, and also listen to the Children of Adam scores, they're written so well for a singer, because they're not like some contemporary composers will write high notes for a baritone consecutively, and your larynx is going up and up and up and up, and you just end up dying, really, to be honest. Whereas he very sensitively approaches it with also good use of dynamics, so it's very well written. But yeah, Martin,
that's very kind. All I can say to Paul is that he may regret that.
We'll say it's not easy.
But no, and I mean, may I've kept very quiet because this is Peter's evening. But Peter, from me, although it's not my place, thank you very much, because apart from the lovely thing about me, I would want to say to everybody that Peter is by no means typical of the young up-and-coming professional singer, because he has a wonderful modesty about what is, I think, a great talent. And to see him, as I did in those concerts last summer, what Peter didn't make quite clear was that in those concerts last summer, he and Holly were singing to people who actually hadn't been out of their house until that day, you know, of a certain age, who had been shielding or whatever. And it was wonderful. He he was concentrating on singing, but I was sitting at the piano and watching the reactions of people in the audience. He did such an important job for those people because they just came alive. And there aren't a lot of people who would put all the effort into doing that. So I would say bravo, Peter, on that. And also, yes, of course, thank you for suffering my pieces. But hopefully at some point we might even get Cantiones and Peter in the same church. Ooh. or barn or wherever
it's on record.
Can actually we can actually perform.
I'm watching Peter's head, he's not shaking.
The challenge actually, if you get Peter to do something, the challenge is to find somewhere large enough to cope with his fan club. What he did say about the Baroque Messiah, which Peter is a great entrepreneur, and he plans all these things out. And the Baroque Messiah, which was Baroque singers and Baroque orchestra, was actually in the parish church in Whitchurch and was just packed out. And they are all Peter's fan club. It just follows him around. So,
can we unmuted clap and a bravo?
Well, thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you, Martin, as well, and Paul, and thank you, everybody. And I'm really glad that you enjoyed it. And yeah, if you do have any questions, just send them to Martin or Paul. I'm more than happy to help out. No questions. How big or small, as well. Yeah. So. Yes, it's been a pleasure. I'm glad you enjoyed the rest of your wine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
have a whiskey.
I will go in now. I can't have it.
Whiskey is for rehearsals now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Happy Easter.
Do you want? Yes, happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Yeah.